Good morning, Oklahoma. Welcome to Cow-Calf Corner. We're to that time of year where the unpleasant topic of anaplasmosis needs to be addressed. And we are joined today by Dr. Justin Talley to talk a little more about anaplas and maybe how we prevent it and what the consequences of it are. Justin, appreciate you being with us. First, define anaplas or anaplasmosis for us, if you would. What are we dealing with here?
Yeah, anaplasmosis is what we call an intracellular bacteria. So it attacks the red blood cells in our cows. And because of that, that leads to some behavioral issues that you see in some of our animals that are not normally very aggressive. They'll become aggressive. And it's because there's just not enough oxygenation in those cells that are infected with the anaplas bacteria. In most of our cow-calf systems, we're worried about our younger stock, trying to protect them. But anaplas is one of those things that will actually affect your older stock. So that cow that's producing a good calf for you every year can come down with anaplas and really go down on you. And that can either go down on you in the form of abortions, just not producing very much milk, which in turn can impact the calf. And ultimately, it can also result in death of that really good cow that you've put a lot of investment in.
What causes it? How does it get transmitted? And then potentially, how do we prevent this thing? What's our cause here?
Yeah, so again, because it's a bacteria, and once an animal becomes infected, they can become infected for life. And because of that, it becomes very challenging when you try to control for anaplas. And unfortunately, Oklahoma is what we call an endemic state, meaning anaplas is always going to rear its ugly head from year to year. The main thing that we need to kind of concern ourselves with is, what are we doing from animal to animal? Whether if we're working those animals or giving vaccinations to those animals or just simply ear tagging those animals, are we ensuring our protocols are in place that we're not contaminating other animals after we treat an infected animal? And that's where most of our problems come into play on the management side of anaplasmosis. When we have, especially these syringe type needles that you can treat multiple animals with, once you treat that infected animal and you never change needles after that, there was a study done at Kansas State that demonstrated that by treating one infected animal successively, you infected six uninfected animals after that one infected animal. So again, you can spread it through your herd fairly quickly if you're not changing the needles or disinfecting the needles in between each animal.
So it almost sounds like one of those things that in Oklahoma, it's almost a best management strategy to assume we have it or that it's right there in proximity. So after we make that assumption, how do we prevent this from causing the bad consequences in cow herds?
Yeah, so you know, the main thing you want to do is develop that veterinary relationship. So once you establish that veterinary relationship, so that veterinary client relationship, then you can request a veterinary feed directive, which allows you to administer either feed or mineral that has low levels of antibiotics. And then the other thing is there is a vaccine that is available within Oklahoma, but there's, and it's what we call provisional license through USDA. It's not commercially available, but you can get it through your veterinarian. And you know, it's kind of hit and miss depending on the strain of anaplasmosis bacteria. But most, you know, areas that we see the vaccine, you know, you see some level of protection.
Good advice. And again, this is a nuisance thing that we have to address. We appreciate you joining this week. We'll see you next week on Cow-Calf Corner.